Good evening. My name is Alexander Hagen. I am the CEO of a medium-sized tech company in Silicon Valley. Previously, I was a financial analyst and a financial journalist and a research engineer in telecommunications. What I'd like to speak to you tonight about is a number of issues going on in the world, but in particular Venezuela, the next potential regime change. Now, prior to the Venezuela announcement by Trump of recognition of Guaido, I was reading a book about Allende's Chile, written by an American who worked for the Allende government, a hardcore Marxist, communist, economist, historian from New York City named Burstein. And he has a book called Inside Allende's Chile, which I highly recommend, Ed Burstein. And in this book, we talk about the collapse of a socialist government in Chile that was elected, similar to Chavez with the Bolivarian Revolution. What we have occur is a pressuring by the United States, a squeezing by the United States, and the CIA kicks off a number of operations. My wife is from Chile, so I've seen what these regime change activities do. They destroy the spirit of nations for decades, even centuries. And we've got to understand the legacy of South America, legacy of vicious colonialism and plunder since 1492, basically. And, you know, 1492 is an appropriate point to enter in, because in 14, shortly thereafter, of course, one of the first places to fall was the Isla Hispaniola, which is what Haiti and the Dominican Republic are today. So we have three major sets of protests and riots going on in the world that are clearly visible: Haiti, Venezuela, and France. And so the most misunderstood one, I think, right now, they're all misunderstood. So in the case of Haiti, what's very interesting is Haiti was the first revolutionary country in the New World, so we should all honor it. They had their independence in 1806. And then what we have to understand is they also funneled weapons to help overthrow the Spanish in Venezuela for Simon Bolivar, the father of Latin American independence, South American independence, who went around South America. All the modern nations of South America, except for a couple, were deeply inspired and affected by Simon Bolivar. Now, as a result, Chavez created a Caribbean investment fund or oil fund, where the Caribbean countries only had to pay 60% up front for their oil from Venezuela, which was probably negotiated at a very fair price to begin with. And a lot of money was created in this fund, the Petrocaribe Fund. And what happened in Haiti is the people that are aligned with the U.S.'s most conservative institutions, because the way Latin America works is you've got a small white ruling elite, for lack of a better word, what they can do is that they can either share the dividends of the nation in a class structure with the people, or they can instead share it with the international corporations in North America, United States, whatsoever. And in return, they get their police and their militaries trained, and they're integrated into our economies. They can we can import their products cheaply. So there's this sort of cynical, in my view, bargain with these small old elites, which were usually comprised of these countries of two main factions, and sometimes more. One would be the agricultural sector, the great landowners, and the other would be the industrialists and businessmen in the towns. And generally, the industrialists and businessmen in the towns were considered more progressive, kind of like the roots of our own agrarian, democratic, and industrialist Republican Party. So in the case of Venezuela, it's very interesting to see how the world has split along the lines of who has recognized Guaido and who has recognized Chavez. Who has recognized Maduro. So I'm going to show you a few exhibits. This first exhibit is the UN Human Development Index. And in this oh, I'm not getting it to the right size I want, but this will have to do. What we see here is that Venezuela is scores similarly to other Latin American countries, and this is from 2018, which you can see right up here, HDI 2018. This is what I use to cut through the bullshit when people say people are starving. Now, I'm not to suggest that people aren't starving in Venezuela. They are not starving in Venezuela, apparently, at a rate greater than Brazil or Ecuador or Peru, and at a lower rate, perhaps, than Colombia or Bolivia, which both have lower human development scores, which is a composite index of a lot of things like education, literacy, sanitation, everything is rolled up in HDI. And the human, this doesn't look at whether the government's totalitarian, fascist, democratic very much. It doesn't deal with the touchy-feely aspect of freedom. So it's just cold, stark statistics about, you know, achievements of the population. So the argument that Venezuela is particularly stressed doesn't show up here. Now, where it does show up a little bit is here in the under 5 mortality rate. So what we found is that Venezuela went from having a mortality rate that was pretty low, if I can find it. Let's see if I can get right in. There we go. And you see, they had 80 deaths. In other words, for every 1,000 kids born, 80 would die before they were 5 previously. This was back in 1960. And by 1990, which is when the conservative pro-American business were still firmly in power, it was at a rate of 30. And it was driven down after, with a brief spike here. It was driven down to 21 at the time of Chavez, and he pushed it down further, down to 16, which is a very respectable number. But unfortunately, we do see a arcing up here. Now, the other issue about Venezuela is how, if they don't succeed in taking it out, the largest reserves of oil in the world, I think it's 600 billion barrels of oil, if I'm not mistaken. It's $60 trillion worth of oil at $100 a barrel. So at any rate, here's how the nations have split up. Mexico has stuck with Venezuela's integrity. So has Guyana and Suriname. This is actually part of France. So it's basically NATO and right-wing dominated Latin American countries. Now, I have a feeling El Salvador is now flipped over to them. So I did this. This may turn from pink to gray-blue. Is that I've found in the UN that Ivory Coast strongly protested the illegal manner in which Guaido was recognized according to international law. The Confederation of South African States recognized the government of Venezuela. Now, I've described these as multipolar, opposing a single NATO-centric world and a tendency to support U.S. NATO transnationals' dominance, the business and military combine of North America and its European allies. So France also recently bombed Chad to take out rebels that were coming in to overthrow a dictator who had been ruling Chad for 30 years. So it's interesting. They came in and defended a highly repressive a man who's been in power for 25 years, who's highly unpopular, bombed the rebels who were trying to overthrow him. And so it seems that with France in particular, they want to have a sphere of influence in Francophone Africa as a quasi set of colonies, a set of affiliated nations, however you want to put it, and have that as their sphere of influence. And in return, they'll support the U.S. as it deals with Central and South America. So here in the Americas, we have, of course, the great Evo Morales of Bolivia, the only strong indigenous leader I know of, Native American person running a country. And then we have Uruguay, which is one of the most enlightened countries in the world. And if the world goes to hell, maybe that's where we should all go at this point. Mexico, Nicaragua, Cuba, and what the Bolton people have come out and said is that there's a troika of tyranny here, or some such phrase, wherein they're going to go after Venezuela first, Cuba second, and Nicaragua third. So this brings to mind this whole issue about studying what happened in Chile. And in Chile, so the first stage, Allende wins the election, I think it was in 69, maybe it was 70. The first year production goes up because you've taken out the middleman. The capitalist profit is removed from these industries as certain industries are expropriated, such as the mining industries. So the first year they're successful. The U.S. begins to put in their blockade. They begin to funnel money and millions and millions of dollars into the newspapers to create a picture of a Soviet Marxist gulag. And the relatively professional El Mercurio there turns into something like a tabloid paper. They also have contacts, of course, with the military and the U.S., the corporations, through the embassy, and they're moving on many fronts to bring down Allende. And so there were many lessons to be learned when they finally fell. So at the very end, of course, they took out all the generals that were constitutionalists through killing, through kidnapping. The Prats was one general. Rene Schneider was another. Eventually, they got the military where they wanted them. Then they paid the industries not to produce. So the truckers wouldn't roll goods. Because the truck, and it's interesting, in South America, the rail lines have fallen apart, and rail lines are better for left-wing countries and right-wing countries, because as long as the transport is controlled by trucking, the country can be brought to its knees through the truckers, who tend to be conservatives. So interesting little factoid, but one of the problems is that there was no way to arm the people. And in fact, a law was passed specifically prohibiting from Allende from arming the people because he did not have a majority in the Congress, in their House of Deputies. So what they have in Venezuela, they didn't have in Chile, is they have armed the people. They have millions of people that are armed in a citizens' militia. The second is to visualize the enemy. There was criticism that Allende didn't do a good enough job of describing who the threat to the people was, which was basically the CIA, the Yankees, the transnational corporations, and right-wing elements in Latin America, and the traditional ruling class of a few hundred families. So then it's important to tell the people what the next moves are going to be. So these are all things Venezuela has done. They are trying to get ahead of the game, and the problem is that if the U.S. fails, they're going to split the world in a way that hasn't been in some time. Venezuela is a little bit different from Syria, how countries break out. There's also Kuwait came out to support the current government of Venezuela. Of course, Turkey, Italy, Ireland, as far as I know, Norway hasn't come out and made a stand one way or the other. All these African countries are likely to come out in support of the Venezuelan government because that's been the position of the, I think it's called now the African Union. Burma came out recently recognizing the current government. Indonesia, in the Security Council, I believe, was not supportive of Guaido, and then New Zealand. So this is creating a split, and I think if you study the world geography, you'll find this split is probably not in our interest, because right now we control South America, but Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Peru, Ecuador, all could return to a more liberal or progressive rule. On the subject of Haiti, I wanted to give you some context here.
Country in the hands of armed gangs and drug traffickers.
So that's the president, Moise.
Latest protests have been triggered.
He's a pro-American type. He voted to recognize Guaido. And Venezuela has been a big generous donor to Haiti. And this, the question is, how much of the riots are related to both the looting of the Venezuelan fund, which is what the riots are definitely about, and also the attack on Venezuela itself and their own president going along with the attack on Venezuela?
Scared by the country's inflation and skyrocketing prices, and a scandal over development loans made by Venezuela, where billions of dollars are unaccounted for. A court report last month suggested that President Moïse had been involved in irregularities. During his election campaign, he promised food on every plate and money in every pocket. As people in Haiti struggle to make ends meet and face inflation that has risen 15% since his election, demands for the president to step down are unlikely to go away.
So there you have it. So let's see here. So bear in mind, this map can change anytime there's an election, from a government aligned towards NATO hegemony and a government aligned towards non-interventionism or multipolar or non-aligned status. So this is all highly dynamic, but right now, the way the U.S. is driving the world is into this sort of NATO plus some right-wing countries. Israel, maybe. Brazil is run by a guy who's not much better than Adolf Hitler, vastly worse than Trump, Jair Bolsonaro. So I think that covers most of it. The other issue is, in order to prevent an overthrow of a workers' government, and Venezuela is rooted with the brown and black people, the mestizos, and these groups are still loyal to the Bolivarian Revolution, by and large, and 52% of the country considers Maduro the legitimate president, the latest poll. So what we have here, we need to make sure that people are willing to sacrifice. And there does seem to be that spirit in Venezuela. And in Chile, that was criticized, that there wasn't enough of a call to ask the people to make sacrifice. But then we also have to mobilize the economy. There has to be a wartime footing for the economy to make sure that these child mortality rates are brought more in line with Cuba, which has some of the best in the world. Let's look at Cuba. And basically, it looks like Cuba should run Venezuela if you're going to use socialism, because what we're looking at here, let's see if I can get this for you. We'll go back a step and look for Cuba. And so you see Cuba has infant mortality of 5.4. The U.S. is 6.6, so they're outperforming us. So how about that? Did I over-zoom? Spain is 3.1, France is 4.2, Britain, so the U.S. is substantially more third world in this category. Mexico is 13.5, Canada is 5.1, so the U.S. is, pretty close to Chile. Italy is doing much better than the U.S., and even Greece, with all of its problems, is doing better than the U.S. And I can assure you that under Gaddafi, Libya's infant mortality rate would have been much closer to Cuba's than at the rate of 12 it has now. To conclude, where can you go to get information about Venezuela? This guy right here, Alfred de Zayas, worked for the United Nations as a rapporteur. He's very knowledgeable, knows all the law, and he considers it completely outrageous what's being conducted against Venezuela, where they're essentially, Maduro has been deplatformed, just the way Alex Jones was deplatformed. You just recognize somebody else, funnel all the country's money to this other location. In the case, they did this in Libya. They confiscate the country's money and give it to jihadists to kill them. These confiscations have been enormous, and some estimate that up to $38 billion of damage to the economy of Venezuela from U.S. sanctions, which have been going on for quite some time. So if you wanted to help Venezuela's child mortality rate go down, lifting sanctions would solve that problem. They have elected government. So be very careful about allowing the recolonization of Venezuela, because that's what this really is. My name is Alexander Hagen. Good night and good luck.